The fact that establishes the authenticity of the originator is the story of how it originated. Well, it all started at Hamilton. I'm a jack of all trade and a master of none at a small liberal arts college at Hamilton. So I have many job descriptions, amongst them after athletic trainer, which leads to this particular face mask, is the fact that I'm a track coach. The history of the mask starts as a history of thinking about how high jumpers stopped a tremendous amount of force by putting their heel out. When you understand track, you start to understand the transfer of horizontal momentum to vertical momentum. It's extremely important in high jumping, in long jumping, and triple jumping. I had been in contact with a Midwest coach who had made a fiberglass heel cup. Well, the whole process of heel cup is distributing the impact over the entire area. So rather than just a small spot on the heel, it distributes it, especially when you see the force coming up by the side. So in my contact with one of the Hamilton hockey players, who's also a lacrosse player, he said, "Gene, you know, why don't we try that with a face mask? And then if the puck hits, you know, at 100 miles an hour, instead of all the impact hitting in one single spot, it would distribute the shock over the entire area of that mask." The beauty of that face mask was the fact that it's custom fit, and then it's so thin, it was probably less than a quarter of an inch thick. We're trying to distribute shock, but we're trying to protect especially peripheral vision. The Hamilton athlete had read in the New York Times that Jacques Plante was interested in a functional face mask. Don Spencer said, "Well, we have the answer to that. I'll write Jacques Plante." Don never got a response from Jacques, but Jacques Plante, the following season, comes out with, you know, the exact duplicate copy. It could have been a twin of our crude and original mask. Initially, you know, Plante got all the credit, because he had visibility and I had invisibility. So, you know, the acceptance of the fact that in all probability I am the, you know, inventor, has led a lot of interest into my life since 1958. A historian in Canada, and you have to remember that historians in Canada probably have a higher priority for hockey equipment and hockey players than they do the history of the motherland. But he followed me for years and trying to establish the fact that, you know, was it Jacques Plante in his laboratory or Gene Long in his training room that really was the inventor of the custom fit face mask? Then finally, in a newspaper article by USA Today on the 50th anniversary of the face mask, he acknowledged the fact that Gene is the inventor of the custom fit face mask. It started with area high schools and area colleges, and then almost forgotten to me was the fact that somehow Don Simmons of the Boston Bruins was laying there and I was making a face mask for him. At that time, I, you know, really wasn't concerned with who it was or why, I did it. Since then, you know, I have one of my grandsons in Boston who's become an automatic, you know, member of the gang. The gang happens to be professional hockey players. And then I find out the next thing is that one of those guys was a teammate of Don Simmons, and in fact, that face mask was called the Hamilton face mask. Well, all of a sudden, that gelled together. You know, it was made in Hamilton College. All of this started after 1958. What I finally realized after, you know, probably two decades, was the fact that the face mask, whether it's custom fit or whether it's designed as an art piece and a protective face gear, was the fact that it changed the whole game of hockey. The career started as humility. It's been humility except for the recognition by, you know, hundreds of young men and finally young women that I had an impact on their life, which was a lot more significant than the impact I had on hockey.